ya. Ligama limbe.
For those presentations, ladies and gentlemen, for me it depicts the different ideological positions that we have as black people, at least those that I acknowledge. The Pan-African origin, those who have strived politically, have subscribed to the fact that Africa is our motherland. And the land obviously has several political connotations which we are not going to touch to. And of course, another biggest, we can't ignore this, because it's a contemporary and historical fact that ANC is one of the biggest political parties that we have had. They have submitted themselves under the slogan of Amandla. And furthermore, the Christians, probably historically through the South African Council of Churches, and more recently, Pastor Frank Chikane himself, both in the Tamumpei and the Zuma administration, represent the feasible and unignorable footprint the church has had in the struggles of this particular country. When they would gather, they would cry, "Malibongwe, Ikamalenkosi." As I've been introduced, my name is Siphesihle Shabalala. I submit myself as one of you. We're just going to pass a few comments on the topic at hand today. I'm going to try and be brief as possible in addressing the topic given to me in the nature of what is the role of the church in politics and governance. My presentation is going to be brief, but it's going to be, I believe, diversified into three categories. One being, what is my comment about the particular topic and the composite it's varying. Number two, because I've been an SO myself, I understand SO not as a church in a denominational sense, but I know that SO is a Christian organization. Mm-hmm. That is why it's not a student church, but mm-hmm. it is a student Christian organization. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to address the topic to that, but I'm also in my conclusion going to address what then, because I believe that some or most of you are formal members of churches. I'm going to just try and draw a biblical or theological conclusion of what I believe is the role of the church in politics and precisely in governance. Mm. So ladies and gentlemen, I want us to be aware that when we talk about politics and governance, either as a study or practice, there are two things that you must take into cognizance or consideration. Mm. One being that politics and governance can come across as a principle, but also politics and governance can come across as propaganda. Mm. As a principle, politics can be observed, can be learned, and it can be analyzed. Mm. That is why day in, day out, when there is a major political occurrence in the country, they call in experts to analyze. And they analyze on the basis of political principles that they have learned or that they have developed because of practice. Mm. So politics and governance, of course, they are government officials that may not be politicians. Mm. Accountants who are involved in governance, development specialists who are involved in government, but they are not politicians. They are not involved in the politics of the day. Mm. Governance itself can be a principle. It can be learned, it can be analyzed, and it can be practiced. But beyond that, ladies and gentlemen, I want us to understand that if we are going to apply ourselves in these things, particularly as Christians, we must not be naive. I believe that this sentiment is voiced out by Jesus when he says, "Niba mnene njengamajuba, kodwa nihlakaniphe njengenyoka." So there is the dove aspect of things, because the dove is not crafty, but it is a polite animal, an animal that you can view in the light and day. Mm. And at night, it is not a night animal. Mm. But a snake is an animal that camouflages. There are ways of the snake that you cannot predict. Mm. And so the propaganda of things must be understood as part of the things that are in politics and that are in governance. And part of the reasons why we may not be able to understand politics, although we have studied, although we have participated in it, it is because as politics unfold, there is the invisible hand, the third hand, what should not be judged through the sun, let's start together. And the propaganda that you may not understand. So if you, as a church, participate in politics or governance, at a campus or at a bigger scale, at a national level, you must understand that don't naively go there, because there are things, as we are now learning, they're telling us about spies, they're telling us about that in politics and governance, the highest person is the president. But now you are told that the president has a hand. It's because politics and governance have principles, the principal aspect of things are propaganda. Let me quickly leave there. So now concerning the participation of SEO as a student organization, SEO does not discriminate on the basis of which denomination you come from. This is the one that I know. We're not going to ask you what is your primary belief and what is the name of your church. But when you say you are christened, we come together with you to fellowship. I don't know whether it has changed, but I know that this SEO, for lack of a better word, has a democratic standard of Christianity. And so I'm not going to delve deep into issues of doctrine, what I believe, or what you believe, or what we should believe. But at least I want to put that across as my understanding, perhaps in this context, of what SEO is and what it stands for. And I want to speak into that as my primary context. Times are changing. Of course, every speaker would love to believe, or maybe it's a popular sentiment that every speaker uses, times are changing. But it is the role and responsibility of every speaker to identify the time within which they are speaking into, to establish a context-specific solution or suggestion that they are bringing across to their audience. And so I want to believe that times are changing. And as times are changing, there is a confrontation of dynamics that we do not know. Both people who study psychology and those who study sociology are now confronted by a type of person that they have never known. So there is a need to reobserve and to restudy the psychology of men and the society within they live, therefore. But not only the component of humanity that we affected, but also science and technology. Of course, you guys may have heard about the fourth industrial revolution wave, whether it's a fallacy in principle or it's a propaganda, nobody knows. But we have consistently heard, we've been confronted by these realities. People are making money at the, I mean, you are coming here to school, there's someone who's sitting there on YouTube putting makeup, and they've been paid for that. So the world is changing, even economies must reapply themselves to understand the world as is. So I want to submit this, therefore, then to you. That if you are going to involve in politics, the politics of things, power dynamics, if you are going to contest power within this campus or beyond, it is important that you understand that which I'm going to present to you as a primary principle. Politics and governance are a contest, even if you don't hear everything I say, but please, yes. Politics and governance are a contest of what is the ideal person we desire to epitomize the society. As on Bahazwe, Nezo Musazwe, the only thing you are concerned about, which Tina says, Umundu, Esimfuna, if a typical student of UT must be this kind of a person. So when you go to contestation, you don't tell us that we're going to fight for everybody, that is low politics. Yeah, we're going to bring you teacher, that is low politics. However, when you get into politics, you say, ladies and gentlemen, you must understand the historical background of this institution. The quality of the person we've been producing is this kind of a person. And so what we want perhaps a computer literate person. Not only that, but we want people who are at the cutting edge of the career that they are pursuing. That is serious politics. Ourselves are going to fight for everyone. That's nonsense. Right? But you must tell us the idea of the person that you envisage.
Okay.
What kind of person do you want to be the example of the society that you want in South Africa? You get what I mean? And because of that, I want to then argue that because of that, Christian organizations, particularly organizations like SEO, who are driven by a particular framework of ideology, must be represented in politics and governance. Why? Because they must shape the policies that produce the person they aspire to. So when you go to council, when we send you to council, we are not sending you to fight for libraries, but we are sending you to contend and contest policies that are going to produce the person that we want.
Yeah, go over
this particular campus must be but more specifically as the country at large. Now, in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, let me touch then, okay, of course, you are a religious institution, but you must offer more than religion now, as I say. You cannot only offer ethical composites. It's great that you must tell us that we must behave and all these nice things, they are great. But because of the nature of politics and governance are not only fixated in one element, which is ethics, but politics are diversified, especially the demand is higher for you because you are academics, you are intellectuals. You can't only focus on ethics, but Christian organizations that are participating in politics and also in governance, they must diversify their focus. They must be able to touch on all composites and elements that are going to bring across the person that you are. Let me close by this manner. So what is the role of the church? As you go back to participate in your churches, I see right now there are many pastors and churches that are affiliating themselves in politics. I want to give my view. Of course, I'm not authoritative. I told you that I'm a commander. I'm giving suggestions, not solutions. I'm just saying what I think and what I believe could be the direction. You can dispute me, or you can agree with me. It's still fine. I'm not God anyway. So for me, the biblical or theological position that I have concerning churches participating in politics and governance is this. The primary role of the church, not a Christian organization, distinguish that. The primary role of a church, where people are affiliated to a particular doctrine and affiliated to a particular God, especially Christianity, because I also believe SO is a Christian organization. I may be mistaken. The primary role, as depicted by the Bible, the role of the church is intercession. That's found in the book of Timothy, I believe, where he says, pray for everybody in governance. Now, if we are going to pick a political party and say, Antina, supporter in ACDP, that means you are not going to pray for the EFF, you are not going to pray for the ANC, you are not going to pray for IFP, you are not going to pray for PAC, because now you have chosen a political side. Now, the role of the church in politics and governance becomes conflicted, because now we are praying in favor of. But the Bible teaches us that every leadership and governance is given by God. So your role is to pray for them that lead you. So intercession is the primary role of the church. It doesn't matter whether you agree with the leader policy or whatever, but the fact that that person becomes your leader, the church has a responsibility to pray. The Bible says, so that it may go well with you.